will begin today's walk by admitting that before this year, I didn't even know the Innu Nation existed. It's sad and embarrassing to admit, but unfortunately, I bet a lot of Canadians don't either. So today's walk is an opportunity to discover an amazing nation I've had the opportunity to learn about, the Innu Nation.
It's actually an incredible Innu woman named Elizabeth Panashway who inspired me to do this lesson through a walk. She organizes winter walks and brings people with her to teach them about the traditional lifestyles and the Innu's relationship with the land along the way. So by following Elizabeth Panashway's footsteps, join me on this walk in the bush as we will learn about the Innu Nation story from pre-contact up to present. Here we go. If I'm shivering while speaking, it's because it's cold outside today, but I'm sure the Innu can relate, since they live in the eastern and northern portion of the Quebec-Labrador Peninsula. Today there are over 16,000 Innu who live in 11 communities in Quebec and 2 in Labrador, but the term Innu Nation formally represents the Innu of Labrador. There is approximately 2,200 persons, most of whom live in the two Innu communities of Sheshashu and Natwashish in Labrador. The Innu language is Innu Inam. It is part of the Algonquian language family. There is also the language Iyu Eyiman, which is a dialect that the northern group speak most. Let's go back and see what this nation was like before European contact. The Innu spent their summers near the Atlantic Gulf of St. Lawrence or James Bay coast and spent their winters inland. They typically lived in local bands of 25 to 30 people and each lived a nomadic life. In the fall, they followed the caribou, an animal who is very respected and important to the Innu. In Innu cosmogony, an Innu man goes to live with a caribou. He marries one of the does and is himself transformed into a caribou form. He becomes the master of the caribou and the provider of the caribou for the Innu people. Papakasiku was a powerful spirit who was the master of all earthly and who led the band on the hunt. Many of their traditional ceremonies reflect and revolve around the caribou or the animal spirits, for example, Makushan and the shaking tent ceremony. For the Innu, killing animals is not an action of power and violence, but more of a loving and respectful relationship. They believe that the animals only let themselves be killed by a hunter who will respect them, who will treat their corpse with rituals, and who will dispose their bones in a proper ritual manner. As you can see, their traditional economic practices revolved around hunting. Their survival depended completely on the animals they would hunt or fish. Hunting would provide for the need of not only food, but also warm clothing, material for shelter, and also for cultural objects. But their way of living was dramatically altered and changed after the arrival of fur traders, such as the Hudson Bay Company and Roman Catholic missionaries in the 19th century. Trappers would persuade and insist that the Innu abandon the caribou hunt to trap furs full-time instead. But as a result of having to abandon their own traditional practices like hunting, the Innu became very dependent on the Europeans' economic practices for survival, food, and supplies. When the drop in fur prices occurred during the Great Depression, and with the decline in the caribou population during the 1930s, the Innu starved and were impoverished. Many felt like they had no option but to look for help from the government, the church, and charitable organizations. Roman Catholic missionaries objected to the Innu's beliefs and were able to abolish many of its rituals, including drum dances, which they believed were connected to the devil. Many Canadians associate the Innu of Labrador with images of children sniffing gas from paper bags since the gas sniffing epidemic in Davis Inlet in 1993 that had gotten a lot of media attention. But what Canadians don't know is that this epidemic was a result of the Innu having been settled and placed in Davis Inlet in 1969 by the government. This new location couldn't provide an adequate water supply, and since it's on an island, the access to the mainland to hunt and fish was very difficult for several months each year. This isolated community suffered from high rates of suicide and substance abuse. In 2002, approximately 680 people from Davis Inlet were relocated to Natwashish. In 2010, the majority of residents of Natwashish voted to keep a 2-year-old ban on alcohol. The Innu have also formed their own school board and has revolutionized teaching and re-energized the whole town. The board added more Innu cultural content to the curriculum, reintegrating traditional ways into everyday school life. This all seems great, and it's a step in the right direction, but after a discussion with a woman who lives in Natwashish, she has confided to me that the relocation from Davis Inlet to Natwashish has created more problems than it has fixed, taking people further out of their element, and now we are talking generational issues. What we found with facilitating the blanket exercise is that youth don't know their own history because the parents' generation is so affected from things like relocation and residential schools. It's created what we call a collective hopelessness, and we are trying to figure out how to affect that through our work. What outsiders have failed to grasp is that the land was also the pharmacy, the educator, the place for proving leadership, and the source of spirituality. Failure to appreciate and accept the basic three principles of the Innu, such as land, family, and control, deprives the outsider of sharing the Innu's worldview, but, most seriously, it risks leading governments and others in a wrong approach into trying to help. This nation works so hard for the survival of their culture and has a lot to celebrate. I realize now that my community and the educational system failed to inform me about so many things. If it wasn't for my minor in Aboriginal Studies at the University of Ottawa, I still would live with the false perceptions and stereotypes towards Indigenous peoples. And that's what I find truly concerning. There remains a large number of Canadians who are misinformed, and I wonder how they're going to know the truth, because we have generations and generations of false information about our history. I feel so privileged to now be learning about the different Aboriginal cultures in Canada, like the Innu Nation. To the Innu, the land is their history, their culture, and their future. The land is a storehouse of wildlife and natural resources that has sustained them for generations, and which they hope will continue to provide for them in future years. I'm learning about their defeats and sufferings, the challenges they have faced, and the ones they are still facing today. Even with their difficult past, it's amazing to see how they've been able to overcome the burdens placed on them and how they continue to defy their challenges. Sadly, the healing and rehabilitation process of these nations won't be possible if not all Canadians are mindful and aware of what went on and what is still going on today.
Well, that brings us at the end of our walk. I realize I might just be some white girl that's talking about large matters that I have still so much to learn about. And I might not understand what it means to be Innu or an Aboriginal person in today's world, but I'm trying. These discussions and research with Innu individuals has helped me understand that whether someone is First Nation, Inuit, Mitzi, or non-status, we are all united as one.
Innu Nation!